Grace and peace to you in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Dear friends, welcome to this celebration of the life of Michael Standridge. We are here to honor our Lord Jesus Christ and to celebrate the life of a Christian who has passed before us. Hear now these words from Scripture. I am the resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Those who believe in me, even though they die, will live. And everyone who dies, who lives, will believe in me, will never die. For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have now clothed yourselves with Christ. In his baptism, Michael was clothed with Christ, and in the day of Christ's coming, he shall be clothed with glory. Hear now that ancient poem of comfort, the 23rd Psalm. And if you want to, pray it aloud with me, whatever version you know. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of my enemies. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Let us pray. O God of love, you who gave us birth, you are ever more ready to hear than we are to pray. You know our needs before we ask, and our ignorance in the asking. Show us now your grace, that as we face the mystery of death, we may see the light of eternity. Speak to us once more your solemn message of life and death. Help us to live as those prepared to die. And when our days here are ended, enable us to die as those who go forth to live again, so that living or dying, our life may be in Jesus Christ, our risen Lord and Savior. Amen. Let's rise and sing in the hymnal, hymn number 202. words from the Apostle Paul's letter to the Ephesians, be filled with the Spirit, speaking to one another with psalms, hymns, and songs from the Spirit. Sing and make music from your heart to the Lord, always giving thanks to God the Father for everything in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. Hear now one of Michael's favorite songs. Hear these words from God's prophet Isaiah. Those the Lord has rescued will return. They will enter Zion with singing. Everlasting joy will crown their heads, and joy will overtake them, and sorrow and sighing will flee away. Michael was a member of the choir for over 10 years, and the choir is going to honor him now with one of his favorite anthems.
Thank you.
people said,
amen. Amen.
I invite now Reverend Freddie McCann, who's known Michael since he was 14 years old, to come and celebrate Michael's life.
I used to take my Bible with me anywhere. I'm not going to preach y'all a sermon. But yes, it was later in my life, as far as my high school career and high school life, that Michael and his family moved to Lone Oak. And he was a couple of grades behind me, and I became acquainted with Michael because he was in a class with a good friend of mine, Curtis Sample and Randy Havens. And we really got to know one another better as I had graduated and spent time with them. And we just enjoyed that great fellowship. Me being the elder one of the group, they called me Uncle Fred all the time. So I gladly accepted that and had some great times there in the home with their family, Casey and Miss Delilah and Gwen. And, you know, they were brother and sister. She was a little sister. And I was there to witness some of the epic battles. But Michael was always a protector of her. Loved her dearly and loved his family dearly. And you could tell that. I enjoyed Michael. One of the reasons, as many of you know, I mean, I don't have to tell you, Michael just had a great, engaging personality. I mean, first thing, he was really handsome. Then he was very personable and articulate. And also, he was humorous. I mean, he was a great, I'm going to use this word, I think he would like it. He was a good raconteur. How many know what that is? A few. That means you can tell a story in an amusing or an engaging way. And Michael could do that. And sometimes they weren't always the very solid truth, but he would tell stories in a way that you enjoyed being with him. And he was fiercely loyal to his family and to his friends, as evidenced by the fact that you're here today to remember him and to honor the family. He would not want it to be a grieving service. He wants it to be a celebration. He would like for it to be you remembering the things of his life that blessed your life, the great times that you had. We only had about 5 or 6 years from the time that me being ahead of them, and then I graduated a few years later, got married, and then as the Lord led me to places to preach the gospel, we had about 5 years of very intense fellowship and close friendship. But that's a part of the foundation of my life and of my story, that Michael's touched me and he helped me very greatly. As I was in Yazoo City pastoring a Baptist church there, he was in Florida, and we had gotten in touch with one another again, and he was asking me about the church, and about that time, we were going to have a youth revival. It was in the summer, and kids were out of school, and we had quite a number of what the community called street kids who would come and attend our services during the summers, and I told Michael some of the problems I was having, and he said, Fred, can I come and stay with you that week and speak to the young people? So we set it up where that we had a young preacher to bring messages in the evening services, and then Michael would speak. We had services in the morning just prior to noon, and after that, they would come to the parsonage, and those kids would talk to Michael. Even my own kids, who wouldn't talk to me, you know. But they knew he had been through some life experiences. He had learned things, and they would listen to him. And I was very appreciative of the time that he took and the care that he had for people that he did not even know prior to that point. I told my children, who are now adults with children of their own, that Michael passed away. They were very sad to hear that and wanted me to offer their condolences also to the family. But he was that way. Though he was a very vibrant person, there were events later in life that did take him to a dark place, especially after the death of his mother. He moved from here and moved back to the West from where they came. He was seeking answers. He was seeking to go beyond just what's on the surface and find the philosophical, theological, and those issues that he thought would help him. And at some point he did. I don't know if any of you, and I'm sure you have, all of you may not have seen it, but he put something on Facebook kind of giving a narrative of that journey and how that he'd come back to the Creator. So I don't have any doubt at all that Michael was a child of God and that he had put his faith and trust in him. So it is at this time we truly can take hold on the promise that the choir just sang so magnificently and he played so wonderfully, it is well with his soul. While we're grieving here, he is at rest there. During that time in the West, he became estranged from Gwen, and I guess from most of his friends and family. We hadn't heard much from him, but there came a time that as he was out there, of course, being his psychology degree and wanting to help others, he was able to get in touch with and somehow acquainted with an Indian tribe and the reservation out there. And they wanted him to come and speak to the 14 and 21-year-old youth that were there. Glenn was relating this story as he had related it. So one of the things that he would do, because you know how it is when you've got a lot of young people, everybody wants to speak at once sometimes. Even adults may do that. But he brought an owl feather. And he said, what we're going to do is, if you want to speak, I'll give you the owl feather. And only the person with the owl feather can talk, and then whoever gets it next can do that. But when he pulled out that owl feather, he seen almost fear on their faces. And nobody said anything. He didn't understand what was going on. Following that meeting with them, he had a meeting with the counselors in the council with the elders of that tribe. And they told Michael, they said, an owl feather represents death in our culture. So that's why they were so afraid to speak and to say anything. So Michael asked for a chance to redeem himself in that. He persevered. And in working with those young people, they came to love him and all respected the impact that he had. As a matter of fact, there were many of them, as he was a mentor to those young people, that looked up to him and wanted to be like him. And that brought him a lot of joy. And he positively glowed over the opportunity to help people and to see them benefit from his counsel, his wisdom, his guidance in their lives. As was mentioned, I think talked about, Michael, he attended with us some. He came to church where I was a member there in Lone Oak at the New Testament Baptist Church, but eventually he ended up here, as was mentioned, for 10 years. And I knew that he could sing, but I didn't know that he sang many times as a soloist with the choir and things that they did, and certainly blessed the congregation here, not only with who he was, but what he could do. But as he was out in the West, I believe it was there that he lost his hearing for a time. And so I'm relating to you what's been related to me. And of course, that was certainly very troubling to him. During that time, he made a promise to God. Lord, if you restore my hearing, I'll do two things. I'll restore my relationship with my sister. And I'll also use my voice to sing for you. And through technology and things and all that was done, his hearing was restored to the point that he did call his sister. They did get reunited, and she even went out to be with him. And so that's a wonderful thing to know. And I know that Quinn was very grateful to Michael and to the Lord for the opportunity to once again have that relationship with her brother. The other thing that he promised, he kept that, he wanted to sing, and he sang again. And he had applied and auditioned, I think, a little bit to be on America's Got Talent. And when he was supposed to go, I believe the first time, then he was not well, he didn't go, so they scheduled another time. But sadly, before he had the opportunity to do that, he passed from this life. But I believe he's singing in heaven. I believe that now he's using his talent. And he was just somebody who always cared about others. Now, I'm not sure who all these people are, but Gwen did say that he had a good friend, Shane. And Shane was to get married, and so Michael had left a note for Shane when he... One point he said, I've left you a gift. And he didn't know at first, but he looked around and there was a hat that Michael had left for him as a gift for him. And so he has the hat. Michael's in the presence of the Lord at this time again. But he just always wanted to do things that would lift up other people, that would bring them joy, that would help heal them if they were hurting, and that would give them confidence if they were doubting. So he always said that he was named for Michael the Archangel. Now, Gwen says she don't know if that's true or not. You might have made that up. It sounded good, but he did feel like that he had to protect people and fight for them. One of the touching things that she told me was that at their mother, there were two swords. He collected swords and enjoyed those, and two were special to him. But when Miss Delilah had passed away and they were holding her service, there was a sword in one of the flower arrangements. And at the end of the service, Michael drew the sword, gave it to the minister, and told him it was no longer his job to fight and protect his mother, but it was now the Lord's job. And that's just the way that he felt. There's a sword here today, and one that he had. And as we think about him today, as I mentioned about, he felt like he had to had to help those who were less fortunate, to lift up those who were low, to help heal those who were hurting, to fight for them in any way that he could. Now he has laid down his sword, and it's his time to rest with the Heavenly Father, with his loved ones who preceded him there. So his sword is here laid down, that he no longer needs to fight, but he is at rest. And I thank God for him blessing my life, as I know you thank God for him being a part of your lives. May God bless you all.
Maybe you're still here. I feel you all around me, your memory so clear. Deep in the stillness, I can hear you speak. You're still an inspiration. Can it be that you are my forever love, and you are watching over me from up above? Fly me up to where you are beyond the distant stars.
Let us pray. O God of compassion, comfort us with the great power of your love as we mourn the death of our dear brother Michael. In our grief and confusion, help us find peace in the knowledge of your loving mercy to all your children. Give us light to guide us into the assurance of your love. We thank you for your servant Michael, whose Baptism is now complete in death. We praise you for the gift of his life, for all in him that was good and kind and faithful, for the grace you gave him that kindled in him the love of your dear name and enabled him to serve you so faithfully. We thank you that for Michael death is past and all pain is ended, and that he has now entered the joy you have prepared through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. My friends, hear now this prayer of commendation as we give our brother Michael back to God. Let us pray. O holy and eternal God, you only are immortal, the creator and maker of all, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. This you ordained when you created us, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song for you, O God. Alleluia, alleluia. Give rest, O Christ, to your servant Michael, with all your saints, where there is neither pain nor sorrow nor sighing, but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we now commend your servant Michael. Acknowledge, we pray, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of your everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. In just a moment, I will offer the benediction. Typically, the postlude is used as a way for people to exit. This was very special to Michael, the piece you're about to hear, so I would ask us all to remain seated, and then we'll exit after it's over. And may the grace of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, the love of God the Father, and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with all of us and with all whom we love and hold dear, no matter where they are right now, both now and always. Amen. Recess over to Fellowship Hall, where you are invited to leave a video message for the family about the life of Michael. So please, let us rise and join God's grace.
With Michael, I wondered if he embellished stories about it. You know what I mean?
I'm in church. You want me to tell a lie?
No, tell the truth.
He made them bigger and louder than they were. He sure did. They were more colorful. But he had a way of telling a story. I mean, you hung on every word because you had to wait till that last line. You had to hear the whole story. You didn't walk away from a Michael story, because there was going to be a good punchline at the end. But he was a storyteller. He really was. And he used to tell me that I was his memory of, like, high school back. He couldn't remember anything, but he could remember forward. And when he had moved away and he'd come back to Lone Oak and we'd go to Walmart, and somebody'd say, "Oh, Michael, how are you? I hadn't seen you in forever." And he'd go, "Who is that?" You know, I'm like, "You graduated with him." And he's like, "Oh, yeah, I remember now. I got that," you know. But it was like, he never let anyone know that he didn't know who they were. He just didn't call them by name until he was like, "Who is that?"
My first thought that we continued to joke about for over 20 years, he took me to his mother's house because he was going to change the oil in my car.
Yeah.
And he said, "Now, you know, when I get it up on the ramps, you say stop." So he drove my little car up on the ramps, and I said, "Stop." And then I said, "It's leaning. I think it's going to fall." Pretty much in just that tone, because the ramp was leaning. And he looked at me like I had three heads, and he said, "What?" And I said, "It's leaning. I think it's going to fall." And at that moment, it fell off the ramps. And he said, "Why didn't you tell me?" I said, "I did. I told you twice." He said, "Well, you were pretty..." I said, "You know, I worked in hospitals. I was on the code team, you know. The worse things get, the quieter I get. So from now on, you need to, like, scream when something's happening like that. You just can't say it in a monotone. It's leaning. I think it's going to fall." And we laughed and joked about that for over 20 years.
Michael.
Well, after Michael died, we took a drive straight through to get out there to be with Julie, because she was just devastated. And I talked with Jim Gamble a while, and he gave us some of the history of how they worked together down there in the prison system, and how they helped those people try to reform their life. And they got a building for them, and the people at the prison kind of took it away from him. And he said something about, "Well, you know Michael and his silver tongue." He went in there and he would talk to this person that knew the governor. And so finally they did get another building for them. And you know, sometimes we have to do that. We have to just address problems that we have. And I think Michael was an ace at doing that. And the only thing, I think he expected to give of himself more than other people. And that's a quality. That's a quality. But sometimes it can drain you.
Oh.
And but I do love Michael.
Me too.
I want to see him again.
Thank you.
guess
he's rude. She's going to see
what wants. Oh, come here. Let's talk. First start by telling me who you are.
I'm Jessica. I am Jessica Toombs. I am Michael's sister-in-law. And we just love him very much. One of my fondest memories is when Julie and Michael decided to move from the farm there in Lone Oak, and they were getting all their stuff together and ready to leave and go to, I believe it was Dallas at that point, when they eventually went to Silver City. Yeah. And but anyway, they gave me a bunch of stuff, and it was just a blessing. What a blessing that they have been, both of them, were to our lives, mine and my husband and my little boy. Love them very much.
I'm Tommy Joe Poucher. Michael was my brother-in-law, and I wasn't married to his sister, me and Michael continued to be friends for years and years, and we just did so many things. And of course, you know, we were friends for so long. He went through, you know, my mother and my father passed away, and all of that was, Michael was there, and you know, and he was just such a, Michael, they said it perfect today, he had a way of talking and just making you feel better. I mean, no matter what it was, I think about today, if he'd have been there, I don't know, nobody would have been crying, because he'd have took care of everything, you know. And but we rode motorcycles together. We went to numerous events with motorcycles, and of course other friends of ours went too. But me and Michael and a friend of mine from Missouri, we were the first to try a lot of things. I mean, we were the first to go to Daytona. We were the first to go to Sturgis, South Dakota. We went for several years before anybody went besides just me and Michael and my other friend. And, you know, we did everything together. Michael was at my house, him and Julia stayed there with us for about a year. Mm-hmm. And we went to eat together. We played together. I mean, we just were that close for a long, long time. And then I went out while Michael was in Tucson and stayed with him a week. Oh. And we went to different things, and he took me, I'm an Old West fan, you know, the Old West, and we went to Tombstone, and we just went everywhere. And he was a brother to me. Yeah. And I think I was a brother to him. And I believe that with all my heart.
Yeah, I've known Michael for 27 years. He came into my jewelry store looking for gifts for his mother and for, I believe, his co-ed at the time in 1991. And he told me a little bit of, you want to hear some good stories?
Oh, yeah.
Well, in 1991, he was telling me that he used to be in the Collins Lock and Lassiter bond firm in Little Rock, Arkansas. And no other than Bill Clinton was in there too. And they were doing something a little illegal, but Michael was the only guy that didn't go to prison or die when all that went down. And like I say, in 91, 92, Michael had a pager, and the Democrat Gazette, newspapers from all around the country were calling him wanting to get that story. And I saw it on his pager. He said, "Nope, he's not getting into that." And, you know, so he, you know, if he did, you know, he didn't want his 15 minutes of fame. He didn't need it. So that was a really good time that we had, and I had an ex-wife at the time, so about 97, she decides to do something called the creative anachronism thing. She was gone every weekend, wasn't paying attention to me and everything. I said, "Mike, why don't you look at this and see if it can help, what you can help us." So he got to come in and meet her and, you know, listen to her and chat, and after it was over, he said, "John, my brother?" I said, this bird is not going to fly. I said, peeling a magic wand is not going to cure this wounded bird. I said, you need to prepare your exit strategy, and I did. He was always my brother. So we talked, when he moved out to, we didn't lose contact, we talked or texted about every couple of weeks and talked once a month or so. And it's hard to talk when he was in, you know, out in the desert and stuff.
Yeah.
I couldn't get through to him. And we talked a lot and he helped me through some hard times and some good times. He helped me get my son from my ex-wife. He helped me with that. The judge was crooked and my ex-wife employed the judge's best friend, Eastern Arkansas politics. I don't know if you know about that. They're all in cahoots together.
Oh, yeah.
Well, he helped me file a pro se writ of mandamus to get him going, to get him to rule on some things that he did. My lawyer let me go because he said, John, everybody knows that Frank Morledge and this your judge, they're in cahoots together. And so Michael went down to the Secretary of State's office and found out. But the judge he wouldn't admit to it. We found where her lawyer was a campaign chairman for his re-election campaign. He didn't want anybody to know that. And so I got in front of him. I said, well, maybe you can explain this. And everybody started backing up. And I was doing this without a lawyer. Michael taught me how to do it. He said, if you don't have courage, you don't have anything. You'll do things that other people want. And so I took on a standing chancery court judge with him helping me all the way. The judge finally recused himself. And then 3 months later, I was in to go and get my son at age 14. So he helped me all the way. It was really good. And so I have a million other stories, but I sure miss him. He's a wonderful friend, and I miss him forever.
He talked about you
all the time.
Well, we thought that we did a lot of stuff together. I mean, you know, which we were so close in doing things. I mean, with him living there with us, and we just, I don't know, we had so much fun. We worked on RVs together. You know, and I got Michael to RV it. Mm-hmm. And Lordy, we'd work on them and everything break on them, and you know, we'd fix them. And Michael just, you know, Michael would tackle anything.
Yeah.
You know, Michael, I've had a trucking company my whole life, and he always, I want to get away from it because I've pulled wrenches and I'm tired of all that. Michael, that's what he wanted to do. You know, he wanted to get dirty, you know, and we had a very special.
Julie, if anybody had asked me to talk about Jim, here's what I would have said. I always look forward going to wherever it was, Tucson, or Silver City, or Rio Doso, or Santa Fe, because I always got to see the Holy Trinity, and it's not the Holy Trinity, it's Jules, Jingles, and Mike.
Well, we had a good time.
And, we did. And she literally helped me so much because I became delirious with a sinus. You remember this? A bad sinus infection. And I'd been taking medicine. It wasn't doing anything. And I got there, and I was staggering. And Julie said, here is exactly what you need. And you start right now. You're going to be here another 3 or 4 days. It's got to go systemic. And you turn me on to all this stuff. And 3 days later, I was on the mend. Man, you came through for me like a
did
like
you
a,
move? Did you move?
Yes. Closer to my room.
Okay.
Yeah.
Can you text me your ads?
Yes, I will.
And when I text you now, can you get me back to me eventually, all right? We're going to check out.
There's a lot of people that
I know. It's okay. I know what kind of a quandary you're in. Love you.
Love you
I can't imagine. Be careful. We all just love you so much, Julie. You're adorable.
Oh. Well, all right, if you say so.
Got the boots. It
taking the booth, right? Okay, I got them set over there for you.
Any comments I get you? Anything you want to say? Nice, happy?
It's hard for me to say that. Uncle Michael's my pal.
There's a lot of funny things to say about Michael.
Yeah. Yeah.
He always cracked me.
He always got me in trouble. He always got me in trouble, and it was always with a prayer. Remember?
Yes.
Yeah, he'd always have me do the prayer at Granny's house.
Mm-hmm.
And it was always something I learned at school.
Oh, yes.
Remember the turkey?
Tell it.
Three little turkeys are we. We spent all night in a tree. When the cook came around, we couldn't be found. That's why we're here, don't you see?
Yep.
And my grandmother came unwound. She looked at Michael. I'll never forget that. Ever, as long as I live. That and the monkey.
The monkey?
There was a picture of me and him. He had that little monkey, monkey. He just grabbed my face with it.
You start laughing.